Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 1st, 2018. Today is Easter Sunday, Resurrection of our Lord. This is the 10:30 service. Our pastor is Reverend John H. Pollock. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. John H. Pollock.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Welcome as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. Two pre-service announcements. One, the nursery for those who are 4 years old and younger is open. So if you would like to have your youngsters be in the nursery, Now begin our celebration with Jesus. Christ is risen today, hymn number 365 in the back of the red hymnal in your view. Hymn number 365.
This is April the 1st, 2018. Happy Easter. Our opening hymn is Jesus Christ is Risen Today. This is a very old 14th century Latin carol, but part of it was written by Charles Wesley, one of the fathers of the founders of the Methodist Church.
Mercy on us, Christ, and wash away.
Let us pray.
O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. Young people may go with Ms. Lewis for Children's Church, and the rest of us listen to the reading of God.
Gina Pollock will be doing the readings.
Thank you. glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
saying peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. One thing you notice immediately on reading St. Mark's account of the resurrection is that the resurrected Jesus Christ is not seen by anyone. We simply see and read of the reaction of the women to the empty tomb. Now, what if Jesus had not risen? If he had, when the women arrived, still been in that tomb, the rock would have still been in its place, and the guards would have still been at their post. Well, if Christ hadn't risen, first of all, we wouldn't be here this morning, because there would be no Christian community. There would be no Christian faith. No one would have started a faith about a prophet who simply was crucified, dead, buried, and that was the end of it. If Christ had not risen, we would have seen a totally different reaction by the women. St. Mark tells us the women fled. The women were afraid, and that the women couldn't speak. It was like their mouths were frozen. So, by the women's actions, we know that Jesus did indeed rise from the dead. So let us examine what St. Mark is telling us in his account of the resurrection of our Lord. The first thing that St. Mark is teaching us, of course, is that if Jesus had not risen from the dead, then the women would not have fled. As he tells us in verse 8, and they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. They went out from the tomb, that is, they departed from it. They left where they had been, and they fled. That means, that word fled literally means to run away, to escape, as if escaping from something terrible, or to vanish. Kind of like the old Roadrunner cartoons, you know, when the Roadrunner would take off running from Wile E. Coyote and suddenly just vanish in flash of speed. Well, that's how these ladies were running. They were running like they'd never run before. They were running so fast that they probably could have beat an Olympic runner at that moment. Have you ever been in such a situation? That something was happening so that you were fleeing. And fleeing with a sense of fear and a sense of trembling because of what you're involved in. As most of you know, I spent the elementary years and the first junior high year of my life with my family living on my grandmother's farm. And when my mama had been a young girl, my grandparents had raised thoroughbred racehorses. And so we had this big barn, and you went into the barn, and on either side, there were about five stalls on each side for the thoroughbred horses. And then in the back, there were two large pens, which were for the cattle that they raised. Well, I loved playing in that barn and around that barn, and one day I was taking my baseball and throwing it up against the side of the barn and catching it with my long glove. And as I kept catching it, I noticed these wasps flying around. And so I got closer to the barn and I looked up under the eaves. There was a wasp nest. Well, I thought, I can't keep playing baseball if the wasps are going to be flying around. So I had the brilliant idea that I'd throw my baseball at the wasp nest, hoping to knock it down. So I threw the baseball at the wasp nest, and it hit the wasp nest, and the wasps came flying out. But they all stayed up around the eaves. They didn't come toward me. So then I thought, well, this is fun. I'm going to keep aggravating those wasps. So I threw it again, and they all came out of the nest, flew around, went back in, did it a third time. Then I did it a fourth time. And this time, one of the wasps had gotten entirely fed up with me, and he came after me. And I don't know how fast those women fled from that tomb, but it couldn't have been any faster than I was fleeing that wasp. And that wasp chased me all the way from the barn to the back porch door, as I opened the door and slammed it, he hit that screen of that back door and fell to the porch steps. I decided I need to do something inside, and I go back outside for a while. But that's how the women were fleeing every terror. This wasn't supposed to happen in their mind. They totally forgot what Jesus had said about being handed over to evil men to suffer and die on the third day rise. They were coming to that tomb expecting to see the stone in place, to see the guards at their posts, and hoping that the guards would take pity on them and would move the stone for them so they could go about putting the spices on Jesus' body in accordance with Jewish custom at that time. And then they would seal it back when they were done. But that's not what happened. As St. Mark tells us in verse 5, and entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. That word alarmed means to be overwhelmed with wonder. To be overwhelmed with wonder. They didn't know what was going on. They couldn't remember a word of Jesus, but they knew something was different. And this overwhelming with wonder is in describing that type of situation like you had in life whenever you went to something and you were just overwhelmed by the magnitude of it. Like going to the state fair for the first time and being overwhelmed by all the sights and all the smells and all the activity. I can still remember when my parents took me for the first time to the Kentucky State Fair in Louisville. And I was overwhelmed with wonder. We went to the cattle barn and all these cows that were in. And of course I had to see every one of them. And then the pigs and the sheep and the horses. And then we went into the exhibition wing and all those dealers and all those salesmen with all their booths giving away free stuff. And one of the big things with my cousins and I were to, each year were to get the free yardstick. Because after the fair, those yardsticks made great swords to fight each other with in the backyard. And then we went out to the midway. And then all those smells and all those booths of food and all those rides and all those shiny lights and then all those shows that guys were out there trying to encourage you to come in to see and so forth. And so I was filled with or overwhelmed with wonder. And that's how the women first were. And then after the disciple speaks to them, the angel speaks to them, then we have this, that they fled because terror or trembling and astonishment had seized them. That word trembling means to quake in your boots, to really be scared. Your knees are knocking and your whole body shaking. The word astonishment means to be amazed. So they were amazed at what was going on. They were seized by this. The word seized means to be held by something or to be in possession of something. And it is seized. You've got a hold of it. This fear and trembling had got a hold of it. So they flee. The second thing, if Jesus hadn't risen from the dead, is the women wouldn't have been afraid. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The word afraid means to cause to run away. To be in something that terrifies you so much or frightens you so much that you want to get out of it. You want to get away from it. Just imagine those women that first Sunday morning, that first Easter. They're walking to the tomb. They're full of sorrow and grief. They're discussing who's going to roll away the tomb. How are they going to get into the tomb because of this massive rock that's there and these Roman guards. And once they arrive at the tomb, the rock was lying on the ground like someone had whirled it like a frisbee and it had just landed. Matthew tells us in his account that actually there was an angel sitting on the rock. The guards are gone. They fled their posts. And there you go in and an angel speaks to you. Anyone would be afraid in such a situation. Now I know there's some people who would say, oh no, I wouldn't be afraid. Yeah, I would have gone there and the angels talked. I would have been thrilled to death and gone and told everybody about it. But that's, we're looking for 2020 hindsight. We know how the story ends. It's just like Christmas. When somebody hears a Christmas story and they say, oh, I would have opened up my house to baby Jesus and to Mary and Joseph. No, you wouldn't. Because if you lived back there, you didn't know Mary and Joseph and the baby about to come home. You just knew them as they were travelers looking for a place. So you would have said no as well. But there are those who act like they aren't afraid. You try to always tell us that nothing will make them afraid. They're not afraid of anything. They like to brag about it. It's like the story of the two guys that went hunting. The original version of the story is that the two guys hunting were a Hoosier and a Kentucky. And the Hoosier is the butt of the joke, but since we have a son that was born in Indiana and a grandson born, I'm going to change him to a Buckeye and a Wolverine. Michigan and an Ohio State. So these two guys are going to go hunt for bear. And the Wolverine fan, he just bragged about what a great hunter he is, and there's not a bear that could scare him, and he bets he can shoot the bear and kill it with one shot. All these mouthed away, and the Buckeye said, just shaking his head, listening to him run his mouth. So they're walking along the woods, and suddenly they find some bear prey. And these aren't just any prints. These are like the biggest bear, either one of them prints that they'd ever seen. I mean, this is one big mammoth bear that's in front of them. And the old Wolverine fan looks at those bear prints and he tells the bug eyes, and I tell you what, he said, you keep going forward and find out where that bear's going, and I'll follow his tracks back to see where he's been. Suddenly he lost all that. Grandiose, braggadocio. When he saw what he was up against. And that's the way we would have been. Just like the women at the tomb, we would have been all brave. And, oh, we'd go in and talk to the angel like, oh, it's just a common experience. We would have been afraid too. Be standing there in the presence of God's messenger, telling you the message that in your grief, you do not quite understand. And as I said, Mark tells us they were seized. Just trembling and astonishing. Be seized like someone is holding on to you for dear life. When our boys got to be old enough in elementary school to go to haunted houses, each Halloween we'd take them to a local haunted house in the Florence area. And one year, it just so happened that a strip mall across from the Florence Mall, if you ever go down I-75, 71, you see the big water towers that's Florence, y'all. That's the area we're talking about. And two stores in the strip mall had gone out of business, and they had turned it into a haunted house. So we go into this haunted house with our boys, and there's about five or six little sixth grade or seventh grade girls. And they're walking with us, and the first creature jumps out. A wolf man, Dracula, somebody. And they scream, and every one of those little girls come up and throw their arms around my waist and just hang on for dear life. And I'm trying to walk forward. And the boys are going on ahead and didn't bother them. They go, can we stay with you? I said, I guess so. Through that whole haunted house, those little girls, except for one. After the second creature jumped out, she'd had it. They had to take her out. She was so upset, so scared, she had to leave. But the other five had their arms around my waist the whole time. So I was walking with these girls all around the hill, like I had a big long skirt on or something. And all the way till we got to the end. That's the way these women were seized with fear and trembling and astonishment. It's like it had a hold of them that wrapped its arms around them. squeezed them tight. They couldn't get out there fast enough. They couldn't get away soon enough. But if Jesus hadn't risen, there wouldn't have been any reason for such pain. And the last behavior that would not have happened, as St. Mark tells us, they couldn't speak to anyone. It's like their mouths were frozen. It was just so amazed, astonished, bewildered, frightened, every other word, terrified, quaking in their boots, they couldn't even speak to one another. They couldn't share the good news at first with others. Of course, they end up telling them, the disciples. But at that point, it says they couldn't tell anything, nothing to anyone, as the ESV translated. Nothing to anyone. That means they told not a soul. They didn't say a word. They didn't say a thing. They just took off running. But Mark doesn't leave the story there. If you have a Bible, you see that there then are verses 9 through 20. And in those verses, he basically is reaffirming everything we read in the other three gospel accounts of the resurrection. Now, when he rose early on the first day of Jesus of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene. That's exactly what St. John tells us. The very first person Jesus appears to is Mary Magdalene. To Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons. She went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept. But when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they wouldn't believe it. That's what the other gospel writers tell us. They didn't believe it. Even though Jesus had told them, had spelled it all out for them, they had totally forgotten everything. Afterwards, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And after these things, he appeared in another form to 2 of them as they were walking in the country, and they went back and told the rest. Of course, Luke's account of the 2 men on their way to Emmaus, Jesus appeared. So we do see that Mark does go on and talk about the appearance of Jesus. But he wanted, in these first 8 verses, to focus on the reaction of the women. Because that would be the reaction of any of us, had we been there the first Easter morning. We would have fled, we would have been afraid, and we would have had trouble speaking. But, thankfully, after he appears in the upper room, everybody's mouth is able to work. And on that first Pentecost, they spill out into the streets to proclaim Jesus Christ crucified and risen from the dead. If Jesus hadn't risen, none of this would have mattered. We could care less about the women and what their reaction was. But because he did rise from the dead, the world has been blessed ever since. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Father in heaven, you raised your Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead as the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Fill all your baptized people with the joy of his victory and send us forth as witnesses to his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lover of mankind, prosper your gospel wherever it is preached throughout the world, that it may give and sustain faith in all who hear it, delivering them from the power of darkness and bringing them into the joyful kingdom of your risen Son. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of glory, your Son established your church to be a refuge of peace in a troubled world. Raise up servants of your church in every place who will devote their lives to the spread of the gospel and the service of your people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
King of the nations, remember in your kindness all who bear authority in our land and give them wisdom and integrity that they may serve your people according to your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Rock of refuge in every time of need, hear the prayers of all those who call upon you in times of distress, especially those who are lonely and homebound, the sick, the dying, and the mourning. May your Son ever be for them their joy in sorrow, their health in sickness, and their life in death. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bountiful giver of all things, your Son has prepared a feast of forgiveness and life for his people. Grant to all who come to his altar today a faithful share in his unending life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the living, receive our thanks this day for all your servants who have departed this life in your faith and fellowship and who now rest in their labors. Bring us to your grace to share with them in the triumph of your resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Bonnie Singleton and Sharon Leach are the ushers who will bring. We receive the offering plates and we'll take up the offering today. This is April the 1st, 2018. Happy Easter, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're celebrating Easter. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. We're celebrating the resurrection. We acknowledge the crucifixion, the death of Christ. Today we're celebrating the resurrection as Christ died for our sins and he is here with us today. We'll receive him through Holy Communion. He brought us the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is with us, and we believe that Jesus is truly present in the bread and the wine we receive today. He is with us forever, and he is never far away from us. The Holy Spirit is with us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. St. John's Lutheran Church, we acknowledge the resurrection. We celebrate the resurrection at an Easter breakfast today, and we're looking forward to the garage sale, May the 3rd. May the 4th, May the 5th, May the 3rd, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., May the 4th, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturday, May the 5th, 9 a.m. to noon. Bring any items that you would like to donate, no clothes, but other things. For the garage sale, or you can bring baked goods, we're happy to have you there with us. The gift card and the raffle will also be there. That'll be there, great garage sale. We have other announcements. That today is Easter Sunday. We're celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. We are acknowledging. acknowledging the flowers on the chancel stands are for the glory of God and presented by Harvey and Sally Baker in honor of Nathan's birthday. Happy birthday, Nathan. This is in honor of your birthday, the flowers from the chancel stand. Many of the flowers are in honor of many people who have died and gone before us. And we have lilies and hyacinths. We have tulips and pansies. We have many flowers in honor of Jesus' resurrection. We're celebrating that. And that's why we have the flowers on the altar today. Easter breakfast is today. Completed that, we have the bell choir now playing.
You're now hearing the bell choir.
And also with you.
Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join with our ending hymn.
Thank you.
are now watching the members of our congregation receiving the true body and blood of Jesus Christ. Those who are younger are receiving a blessing from Pastor Pollock. We see many children dressed in their Easter, the little girls dressed in their Easter clothes, beautiful altar with all the flowers. We heard a bell choir play. I've decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. That's what we have decided, to follow Jesus. And by deciding to follow Jesus, he is there with us now. He is with us for eternal life. He is with us forever. He'll never leave us. He's been with us with Christians for over 2,000 years. All this time, he has been with us. Never has he failed to be with us. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're happy to have you worshiping with us today. We watch as the pastor is completing the distribution of the elements of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And he will now place the blessed sacrament in the tabernacle. And Jesus will be with us, and he is with us forever, forever and ever. Amen.
Those who came, please stand. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, in his precious blood, strengthen, preserve, and true faith, and the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. We conclude our celebration with Thy Heavens and Glory, hymn number 376, in the back of your worship book. Please make note that after each, the ending of each verse, there will be an interlude from the choir, and then you go to the next verse. Hymn number 376.
Great composer, Handel. Listen to his beautiful song, Thine is the Glory, Moving and Conquering Sight.